Hello everyone. Today we will talk about an important concept in structural engineering, which is the design story drift as specified in ASCE 710. The design story drift shall be computed as the difference of the deflections at the center of mass at the top and bottom of the story under consideration. And by checking this figure below here, the story drift refers to the lateral displacement of one level of a building relative to the level below it. And this movement is primarily caused by the lateral forces such as wind or seismic activity. And by definition, the F2 here is the strength level design earthquake force, del E2 is the elastic displacement, while del 2 is the amplified displacement by CD over I, and lastly, the story drift is computed as the difference of the amplified displacement, and it should be less than the delta allowable obtained from table 12.12-1. And please note that we are amplifying the elastic displacement by the CD over I because we are trying to predict the inelastic behavior of this structure under real earthquake event. And that's why actually it is important to check or to compute the story drift, because the excessive drift can lead to significant damage to the structural components and to the non-structural elements like partition, ceiling, and the facade elements. And most importantly, it impacts the safety of the occupants during such event. Also, ASCE allows the use or the computation of the seismic forces based on the fundamental period of the structure without the upper limit CUTA for computing the drifts using the equivalent lateral forces procedure. Also, we can skip the use of this equation, which is CS minimum. Therefore, to save time, I have included in this Excel sheet all the necessary information. I have taken them from ASCE 710, okay? And now we need to start exporting the displacement results from ETABS software. I will use two locations, the center of mass and this one here, which is called the flexible zone, okay? And of course, we need to use both directions. We need to apply the ELF method in X and in Y direction. Going to ETABS, let's set the plan view to story number 8. And let's choose here the all stories option. Of course, the center of mass is here at the middle. And by going now to display, show tables, joint output, displacements, and we need here to select the equivalent lateral force applied in the X and in the Y direction. And we can clear this one here. Now let's export those results to Excel. And as shown here, we have three steps. The first involves applying lateral forces at the center of mass, while steps 2 and 3 involve applying lateral loss at the shifted center of mass or with the eccentricity. Then we need first to choose step number 1. And now we need to copy the displacement results in the X direction. And similarly, we need now to use the second load pattern, and we need to copy the displacement results in the Y direction. Oops, I did something wrong here. I need to use 1 instead of 3. Okay, now we need to copy those to our Excel sheet. We need to copy them to here. Now we need just to do the same for the flexible zone. We need to go to ETABS. We need to select this joint here. And from the same options, we need to obtain the displacement results. Okay, I will stop the recording screen and I will copy the results in the same manner to our Excel sheet. Okay, I have finished copying the required information, and let's zoom to the first table here. And what I have did here, I'm amplifying now the obtained displacements by the CD over I. And we need to provide the story height in order to compute the story drift ratio. Because by definition, the story drift ratio is the difference of the displacements divided into the story height itself. And I'm using the allowable story drift of 1.5%, which is taken or obtained from this table of ASCE 710. Of course, in our case, we need to use the 2% instead of the 1.5%. However, I'm trying to be more conservative and in the safe side. And as shown here in this figure, I'm trying to sketch the story drift ratio for the center of mass and for the flexible zone, as shown here. and the story drift obtained is too far from the allowable one. Therefore, our structure have enough lateral capacity to resist the drift, and the drift ratio is not critical in this situation or in this project, because at the end it is low-rise building and it is not a tall building. And of course, I'm using the normal ELF method, but if we want to follow what is written here in this paragraph, we need to go to ETABS and we need to define a new load pattern with the type of the seismic drift as shown here and here. However, all inputs inside are just the same. And what ETABS actually do in this case, if we go to this sheet, the base shear is just the product of the CS multiplied by W. Then T will affect the computation of the CS used. For example, if we follow here the calculations, the T used is just the minimum of the T maximum and the fundamental period. Then what they are trying to say, use here the fundamental period, which is this number, instead of T maximum. Then the computation of the CS maximum will be affected if we change the T. If we increase the T here, we will get a smaller CS maximum, and in this way, we could obtain a lower base shear. Then let's check what's going to happen if we change the T used to the fundamental period. As shown here, we still have the same base shear, and this is because the CS maximum is still greater than the CS obtained from this equation. Hence, using the fundamental period will not make any difference in our case, okay? And now let's return to our Excel sheet. And we need now to obtain the story drift ratio from the response spectrum analysis method. And keep in mind that the RSA quantities represent the total combined response. Then we should obtain the drifts directly from ETABS, and it is wrong to compute the drifts from displacements as we did for the LF method. And according to ASCE 710, we need to multiply the displacements and the drift quantities by the CD over I factor, and we need to include the scaling factor when calculating the story drift ratio. Then by going to ETABS, I have defined two load combinations for obtaining the displacements and the drifts using the RSA method. And as shown here, the 4.5 refers to the CD over I factor, while the selected load combo refers to the reduced RSA, which is multiplied by I over R and without the scaling factor. However, the scaling factor was obtained to be equal to 1, then it doesn't make any difference if we use the reduced or the internal force, as both load combo will yield the same results. Therefore, the final factor used in this load combo is the CD over R, which is 4.5 over 5. Thus, we are obtaining the drift ratios using 90% of the original spectrum response. However, in my Excel sheet, I will obtain the drifts without applying any reduction to the original spectrum using these load cases. And for those who are not familiar with these load cases, please go and watch my previously uploaded video, which is tutorial number 14. These load cases should provide higher drift values compared to the load combinations defined in ETABS for the displacement and the drift check. Also note that the accidental torsional effect is included in these load cases, okay? Then let's export the required information from ETABS software for the same locations used before. If I want to use this location now, I can obtain the displacement results using the ELF or response spectrum analysis method. However, I will not be able to obtain the joint drift directly from ETABS. And that's due to the reason that ETABS provides the joint drift results on the joints at the column ends and at the ends of the structural components like walls and at the corners of the slab here and here, okay? However, we cannot obtain any drift results for those joints at the middle here. And let me show you, if I go to display show tables and I want to select now the joint drifts option, and I will use the response spectrum analysis in X and Y directions and the load cases of the ELF method. And now if I click OK, we will get an empty table with no results. Then we need to use an alternative joint located at one of the column ends close to the center of mass location. Then let's use the all stories option and let's select again this joint here. And from the display show tables, we need to select the joint drifts option. And of course, we don't need the ELF procedure. We need just those load cases here. And let's export the results to Excel. And now we need just to filter the results as we have did before. And we need to copy the drifts in X direction for the load cases in the X direction. And similarly, we need to copy the drifts in the Y direction for load cases defined in the Y direction. Okay, I have finished copying the required results for the center of mass location, and now we need just to do the same for the flexible zone. However, now we can obtain the joint drifts of this corner joint here, because it is located, as I have told you before, at the corner. Then we need just to do the same to obtain the joint drifts due to the response spectrum analysis. And similarly, we need just to filter the results again and to copy them to our Excel sheet. Then I will copy those results directly to our Excel sheet. Okay, I have finished copying the remaining results, and as shown here in this figure, or in this one here, the design story drift ratio is less than the allowable one. Hence, our structure have enough lateral capacity to resist the lateral loads and the drifts, and we don't need to do any modifications at this level. For example, if the design story drift obtained was larger than the allowable one, we need to increase the lateral stiffness of this structure by adding shear walls or columns at certain locations. However, we don't need to do this, and we can proceed to the next things. But before ending this video, guys, I would like to show you this PowerPoint. I have been asked once what load combination should I use to check the drifts. And my answer for this question is shown in this PowerPoint. And before going into details, we need to understand the differences between the serviceability and the ultimate limit state conditions, as each have its own purpose, okay? In the serviceability limit state, we want to ensure that the structure remains functional and comfortable for the occupants during the normal use. While in the ultimate limit state, we assume the worst case scenario, and we want to ensure that the structure can withstand the extreme conditions without collapsing. Of course, when we talk about earthquake loads, we are assuming the ultimate limit state condition. While when dealing with wind loads, we can assume the ultimate or the serviceability limit state condition, depending on the case, okay? And for example, if I go to slide number 1, I'm showing here the factored load combinations used for the strength design, which means they correspond to the ultimate limit state condition. And of course, using those load combinations, we can check the seismic drift. Then these load combinations can be used for checking the seismic drifts, as they correspond to the ultimate limit state condition. And when dealing with the earthquake loads, we assume the structure will exhibit some cracking leading to reduction in stiffness. Therefore, the seismic drift checks are part of the ultimate limit state condition. While for wind loads, they focus on the serviceability requirements, and under those service loads, we don't expect any cracking and the structure should remain in its elastic range. Then if we want to address both conditions, we need to create two models, one for the serviceability and another one for the ultimate limit state. However, for now in ETABS, we are working within the ultimate limit state condition because we want to design this structure and to determine the reinforcement, okay? Then to check the wind drift, we need to create another model. This model has higher stiffness, and I want you to note that the drift limits for wind loss differ from the one used previously for the seismic loads. Now we need to check the drifts obtained with the limits ranging from 1 over 600 to 1 over 400. And as shown here also in this load combo, we are using the service loads without any factors or without magnifying the dead or the live loads. Then we are trying to be more realistic. We are just trying to check the response of this structure under the actual loads without any magnification, okay? And lastly, I want to say, guys, don't follow me blindly. I'm just trying to give you an idea. And at the end, I have taken those info from ASCE 7, 10, or 16. Then please go and check the commentary appendix C of ASCE 7, 10, or 16 if you want more information about the serviceability requirements and what we should consider when dealing with wind loads. And this is the end of this tutorial. I hope you find it useful, and please stay tuned for my next video.